All right. Very, very good evening to all of you. We have a very different type of session today. In this particular thematic session, we have with us one of India's most distinguished public intellectuals who masquerades as a politician. He is a distinguished minister for information technology and digital services with the government of Tamil Nadu. He has had a very long and distinguished career in the private sector as an investment banker, but before that studied in some of the leading universities in the world, including MIT. What I thought we will do is that the theme of this, we call the fireside chat, is that the constitution and the idea of India, a 75-year journey. We want to keep it as interactive as possible, both from our standpoint. So I'm going to request him to make some introductory remarks, maybe for 5 to 7 minutes on the broader theme of the idea of India. And then me and Professor Sudarshan will ask a few questions, and then we will throw it open for all of you. Our goal is to do this for an hour, so we have good time with us. So that's how we'll proceed forward. So thank you very much, and over to you, Mr. PTR Thyagarajan.
First, thank you very much, my good friend, the Vice Chancellor, the Dean. I feel almost like I'm part of the Jindal University network now, in terms of how many times I visited here and how many functions I've attended in Chennai in the US. And I'm always happy to come back, because creating institutions of excellence is not a small thing. And in a country like India, we need many, many, many brilliant institutions, because we have so many people and so many young people. So first, I want to applaud the work that has been done here. And thank you for inviting me to be part of this brilliant initiative. I must also say that it was both eye-opening and awe-inspiring experience to take a tour of the museum just now. I have seen an extensive presentation of what was in it in a slideshow that the Vice Chancellor showed us in Chennai about a week or 10 days ago. And yet, to actually see it in real life, to touch the exhibits, to get the interaction, is quite an amazing experience. So I'll start from there, because I think, we simply sometimes don't understand the level of effort it would take in a land which has millennia of recorded history, where people of all different types have settled at various regions at various times for at least a few thousand years, from the Bronze Age, from the Iron Age, to create a country by simply having a few hundred people set together and come up with a constitution in practically the blink of an eye relative to the millennia, about 3 or 4 years, is unprecedented. Of course, nothing is truly original. And this document also, as in the museum, shows how we borrowed liberally, not just from the British system that we had all been under for a while, but also other countries like Australia and others, and even Germany, I've seen in this text now. So while it is not truly original, in many ways it is unprecedented, because at the time I think the population of India was about 300 million people. The scope of diversity was amazing. The scale of the country was quite large. And so to come up with a constitution and to deal with the many conflicting aspirations of the people who had fought hard for independence is a Herculean task. I happen to glimpse something that is very close to our heart, which is the notion of what should be the official language of the country and the different strong views that went into it, the compromise that was achieved at that time, and then it had a long history we can talk about if it comes to that. I mean, it led to many, many other things, including great strife, many deaths, many riots, and so forth. But that's just one idea, one issue. So in that sense, it is a remarkable piece of work. But I would say it was largely a vision document rather than a very detailed and practical, execution manual, if you will. For example, though it talks about India being a union of states, at the time, the states were not even defined. Basically, the states were not defined till 1952 and then amended 56. And many times since then, most recently 10 years ago, when Telangana was split from Andhra. So in some sense, it is seen as a vision document rather than a kind of operating manual, which many constitutions are. And as I spoke with the Vice Chancellor at the Harvard Law School when we were there in the summer, just for comparison, this constitution, which is about 75 years old, has had 101 amendments. In a country with the diversity and complexity that we have, with the requirements for two-third majority and judicial review, yet we have had 101 amendments. And you compare that to, say, let's say, the US Constitution, which was written much, much earlier with much less kind of vision of the technology of the future, and yet has had, you know, less than a few dozen amendments over 200 plus years. So I think we see it as a living document. In some ways, that's a good thing because it adapts to the needs of society, which are always changing. In some ways, maybe not such a good thing if it's that easily changeable. So the notion of basic doctrine, etc., I think will be increasingly in focus as we start to see more and more polarization in our political spectrum, much like in the rest of the world. So why don't I stop there and make it more interactive? Thank you.
All right, thank you so much. So let me begin by asking a very important question from where you did briefly mention. What was the vision of the framers of the Constitution as far as the idea of India is concerned? The reason this question is important is that this was a time when the key leaders, of course, Sardar Patel had played a very significant role. Hectic negotiations were taking place across the country as to who will join the union and how it will be done. So the Constitution framers were framing the Constitution of India, and what was their vision of the idea of India?
It's a very difficult question to answer because, you know, there were at least hundreds of members in the assembly, and though there were tall leaders whose views probably dominated much of the discussions, there was no history of this kind of democratic exercise where many people had input. Especially, as I say, because, you know, you have people who have been in the land for thousands of years who have different languages, different habits, different cultures, different practices. So I have to assume that the preamble is really the essence of the vision, that it should be sovereign, that it should be socialist, it should be with fundamental rights, and it should have, you know, some notion, which though the word secular was inserted later, but some notion of the ability to practice your freedoms and not have to conform to homogeneity. As I say, that vision was only broadly defined. And to be fair, a lot of the details were left out. If you compare, I'll give you one example. Which is very, it's a tiny example, but it's a meaningful example. So somewhere in Article 293, subsection B or A or something, there's a clause that says that though the states are sovereign to manage their own finances, if a state has any outstanding debt to the union, then without the union's consent, it cannot increase its debt or increase its liability. Right now, yeah, as a former banker like me, we see this is the equivalent of a first lien right. If I'm already indebted to you, I shouldn't be able to increase my leverage because it may affect my ability to repay you. But in some other sense, it is a huge impingement on the authority or the notion of legislative rights to a state, because between the state and the union, at least the way it has worked out, partly because of the need for financial markets, we have to have back-to-back loans. Let's even say till last year or till 2 years back, till this notion of capital grants, 50-year loans and all that, states like Tamil Nadu had no debt to the union in reality. But in practice, we had debt to the union because we're the number one state where there's a lot of World Bank, KfW, JICA, ADB, you know, multilateral and bilateral funding agency lending. And under the conditions of foreign capital markets at the time, because states didn't have credit rating or the ability to access the foreign exchange markets themselves, all these loans are in principle signed between Tamil Nadu and the World Bank. In practice, they are back-to-back loans between the World Bank and the government of the Union of India in dollar terms, and then one in rupee terms between the government of India and the government of Tamil Nadu. Now, that has been invoked as saying, because of that, even though you have your own FRBM or equivalent act, you, the legislature, cannot decide how much money the state shall borrow. In fact, the finance secretary or some joint secretary in the Department of Finance in Delhi will send you a letter saying you can only borrow 86,452 crores, right? Completely usurp the right of the legislature. I don't think the Constitution envisioned such actions coming 30, 40, 50, 70 years down. So in some sense, it was only a vision document, as I say earlier, and the vision was relatively pristine. It should be a federation, it should be a union of states, there should be parallel legislative powers. It's not a hierarchy, it's parallel forms of government. There should be freedom, there should be socialist, there should be secular, there should be, you know, fundamental rights, and there should not be, as we just saw in the museum, this notion that we should not allow too much power to concentrate in the hands of too few people, because that is antithetical to the notion of democracy.
Thank you very much. You mentioned it's a vision document. Now, you represent, in a way, a political lineage in our country that emphasized equality and self-respect. Your forefather, grandfather, was a president at one point of the Justice Party. E.V. Ramaswamy Nayagar talked about self-respect. And much before the Constitution came into existence, or much before we became free, the idea that the future of the country depends on equality as a principle. And in one of the earlier discussions with MPs, one of the MPs cited positively the three authors who got the Nobel Prize, who argued that if you have good institutions and the rule of law, you will have prosperity. You know, we couldn't quite engage because China is an exception and India is an exception. India, so you know, has all the good institutions derived from Britain, much like also the United States or Canada or Australia, and we haven't done very well on equality. And so, whereas I think the movements with which you are a legatee have emphasized that equality is the foundation for prosperity. And even the other big powers like the United States or other countries that have prospered have also had equality, much greater equality than we have. So I'd like you to reflect a little bit about how are we to pursue this ideal, the vision in the Constitution of equality.
Well, if you don't mind, I'll separate those into two different perspectives. One about the notion of equality, which has been a struggle. I was reading up a lot to come for this discussion. And for example, the notion of reservation is really a very interesting point from which to look at the lens of equality. But just so I don't forget, when I'm done with this, I want to say something else about the notion of strong institutions and good growth or good outcomes for people, because there's already been a lot of work on that. Of course, I'm partial because Simon Johnson and Darren Acemoglu are MIT professors, and so I have had the distinction of the unique privilege of taking classes, not the unique, but unique maybe to my set of politicians, of taking classes with them when I was at MIT. But this notion is also reflected by others, most notably Neil Ferguson, who has talked a lot about, in his last or two books ago, the Great Degeneration, where it's a degeneration of the institutions in places like the US or UK that have led to bad social outcomes. So that's a different issue. But the notion of equality, if you look back, let's say, in the Justice Party government of 1920, they legislated the notion, what's called the communal geo, where they showed some statistics, and they said, this particular community that makes up 3% of the population has between 60 and 90% of all jobs in those days, Munsif, district, additional collector, you know, judge, this thing, that thing. How is this representative of our society? And so they passed a communal GO, which basically, you know, it was quite relaxed reservation. This, they said, people who are now, you know, the 3% of the population can have up to 20 or 16% of the jobs. But then all these people who have been oppressed for centuries, the Adi Dravidars, should have 18% reservation, and then so on and so forth. So they said, roughly, though not exactly, in a gradual way, you should have reservation based on the percentage of the population so that all components of society participate in the development, in the progress, and education should be the basis for this. Therefore, compulsory elementary education for boys and girls in 1920-21. That's the vision. Now, in the Constitution of India, it says you shall not discriminate based on race, community, this, that, etc. So actually, there was a huge conflict. And the challenge came to the communal GO of Tamil Nadu, which was, you know, descended from the communal GO of Madras Presidency. And it had to go all the way for a constitutional amendment before they allowed the notion of reservation for people who had been oppressed and so forth. So I think the economic outcomes speak for themselves, which is that if you have inclusion of everybody in the system, starting with the education system, then in the employment system, then in the special employment categories like government employees and people who exercise power in terms of granting licenses or giving you certificates, and then through property rights, through the right to a marriage without having to pay somebody exorbitant. You know, there's a spectrum on this. The more you have inclusion, the more you have every component of your society have access to the pathways of growth and progress, the better economic outcomes you will get. That's not debatable, I think. If you look at Tamil Nadu, we're about, I don't know, less than 6% of the population. We're about 10% of GDP. We produce about 20% of the technical graduates of the country. And that's because we have inclusion. Everybody's there. And we've been doing it for 100 years or 100 plus years. The notion of institutions and government, I think, is, as I say, already discussed by many. I mean, this work for which they got the Nobel Prize is at least 15, 20 years old. And some argue that they focus too narrowly on the notion of good institutions, in this case, about what Adam Smith said first. He said the foundation for prosperity and growth is inalienable property rights and those that are enforced by the state. And you can never... and if there is a dispute, there should be a rapid dispute resolution mechanism based on precedent and you know, fast outcomes. So this notion may be too narrow, but if you look at other people, I say, like Ferguson, he shows that when countries or societies had their greatest surges of growth is when these institutions were truly independent and functioned as checks and balances on the concentration of power or authority or economic heft in the hands of a few. And when those institutions started sliding and being captured by people, most notably my good friend Dr. Raghuram Rajan wrote a book back, I don't know, 15 years ago, saying Saving Capitalism from the Capitalists, where he was, you know, indicating this trend around the world that the big winners, the big tech companies, the big oil companies, the big telecom, who become hundreds of billions of dollars worth, basically can influence the process of democracy through lobbying, through capture of politicians, in such a way that they will no longer allow a level playing field. They, you know, once you get to win the fort, you build the moat around the fort so that nobody else can compete with you. So that has been happening a lot. And that's what strong institutions are supposed to prevent. And I dare say it's not an India problem, it's not a, you know, Asia problem, it's not a developing country problem. All over the world, we have seen more winner-take-all outcomes, partly driven by technology, partly driven by global integration, partly for other reasons. I mean, global by trade integration and economic integration. But the net result is all over the world, we're starting to see the independence of institutions decay. And we are starting to see the consequences of that on society, not just in terms of slower growth. China is an exception we can talk about later, but even China is now paying the price. China is never going to go back to the rates of growth that they had during the 20-30-year period between 1990 and 2015, let's say. Yeah.
All right. Since we are celebrating the 75th anniversary of the adoption of the Constitution of India, I want to take you to the last speech that Dr. Ambedkar gave in the Constituent Assembly on 25th November 1949. He talked about various things, but one of the things he said was that essentially when we adopt this constitution, we will have political equality, but we will be continuing to struggle to achieve social equality. And he clearly recognized that as a problem. Now, my question to you is that while we have been able to achieve a lot of political equality, it's a twofold thing. How far are we doing on this aspiration to achieve social equality at a national level? But on the political equality side, I want to ask you that we have now become been an electoral democracy where there has been smooth transitions of power, and we've had, you know, we've never had, you know, essentially no government which loses is kind of clinging to power. But at the same time, do you feel that politics has taken over governance so much so that we may have to kind of think about how do we save politics from politicians kind of a book, because the idea of politics has become so deeply embedded in governance decisions, and the fact that people who win elections end up essentially asserting themselves so strong that there is no other way of seeking accountability during the time people hold power.
Yeah, it's a very, very delicate question. And I'll say it again, maybe from the narrowest perspective to the broadest. At the narrowest, I would say social equality and equality of access or inclusion is not an end in itself. It's a means to an end of a fairer society, of participation of everybody, of improvement in the quality of life of everybody, of better public goods and services. So, you know, it's a means to an end to have a better society. In that sense, I would say, in some places like Tamil Nadu and Kerala, we have achieved social equality maybe even better than we have achieved equivalent economic uplift, right? So we are 2x or 3x the national, you know, average of GDP, but we're probably 5x improvement in social equality. So in some sense, even there, the promise has not been fully realized. And yeah, there's a lot of things we can do more. Has caste been eradicated in the country? No, not even in the most progressive states. So we have a lot more to do. But this notion of the capture of institutions is really the other side of the decay of institutions. Institutions decay because they get captured, sometimes by industrialists, sometimes by politicians. But I have a very interesting take on it after having served in opposition for 5 years and then effectively the Minister for Administration for 2 years, where I was Minister for, you know, many things, finance, pensions, personnel, administrative reforms, planning, development, etc. In the basic problem, in my view, is that the system of administration, the platform of government is failing. It has not kept up with the complexity, with the needs of the scale, the scope, the issues that we have to face as a democracy or as a country. If I look at it as organizational design or organizational optimization, we have not kept up with the capacity to deliver the outcomes that we should under the Constitution. And what happens then? If the system is failing anyway, I see my good friend the judge, if the system is failing anyway, then it's easier for people who are elected to power to see the mandate as, let me turn the failure to my advantage or my philosophy. Because fixing the system is a lot harder than kind of short-term leveraging the crack in your own interest, right? So that's, to me, the underlying problem is that we have not invested enough, we have not got enough capability in government, and so a crack system can be cracked in my way rather than cracked broadly.
Thank you so much for that. Sudarshan, with your question, after your question, we'll move on.
Yes, you know, one of the things that are coming up, I mean, you mentioned that when the Constitution was drafted, we only had, you know, we didn't even have states, but we had two tiers of government, and it was only much later that we got into devolution. And then now there's some anxiety about what is a representative democracy mean in this country? I mean, what is an MP supposed to do? What is an MLA supposed to do? And what is a local councillor supposed to do? And I don't know if we've got that distribution of authority and power right in that respect. But then we are concerned about the new delimitation that's around the corner after the census, when all the southern states will have fewer seats in parliament. Should we worry about it? Should we not? So I'm linking two issues, one that's coming up, and one, the nature and the meaning of representation, and what is an elected person supposed to do to his constituents, and which constituency?
Yeah, as you say, the original design only had two levels of government. Till the 90s, we didn't formalize the third level of government. I think, again, the global literature and the history is very clear. The closer you devolve revenue generation and decisions of spending, particularly on public goods and services, closer to the people, that is the lowest tier of government, the more likely you get good outcomes, right? Like in the Constituent Assembly, Dr. Ambedkar has said, there will be a natural tendency to centralization. The problem is that the center cannot if it is not strong enough for its weight, it will collapse under its weight. Meaning if it takes too many responsibilities and doesn't have the capacity to execute on them, it's going to collapse and fail, which is basically what's happening in many ways. But I would even say the devolution between center and state is changed a lot. The current prime minister, when he was chief minister of Gujarat, was the greatest advocate for states' rights, probably in a generation. Now he is the greatest centralizer. You take the local bodies, I would say states like Kerala have devolved a lot more power. Tamil Nadu, we have devolved some, but there's been some history where we were worried about communal capture of power, and so the state still retains a significant amount. Other states, it's devolved even less. Delimitation, I think, is, of course, of great concern. But there's an elegant solution to all these problems, which is that if you devolve the powers closer to the people where they take care of their own interests directly, then it doesn't matter, and the national government only takes care of national issues, foreign exchange, foreign relations, foreign trade, interstate trade, the defense, these things, then I'm not so worried how many MPs I have, right? Surely my interests and those of UP are aligned when it comes to having strong borders and strong currency. It's if you start saying they collect all the revenue and they decide how to devolve it, then I start having problems. And as I have shown somewhere, it's in the official figures, the devolution of funds from the center, partly through the Finance Commission, partly through discretion, has changed so dramatically in the last 10 years. In 2014, if Tamil Nadu got 1 rupee, UP got roughly 2 rupees 95 paise. In 2024, if Tamil Nadu got 1 rupee, UP got 4 rupees 25 paise. That's a pretty big jump. What it means mathematically is that there's 1 lakh crore rupees additional to the trend line growth that is being allocated discretionarily for the most part by the government of India to UP. This is when they have 80 MPs and we have 39. What happens if they have 140 and we have only 40? Then I start worrying about these things. A different story. But if I really want to address your question, the bigger concern I have by far today is that the roles of the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary have all become muddied dramatically, either diluted or muddied, in the sense that ever since the scale of representation changed, that is, if you want to be an MLA, around the country you have probably 3 to 4 lakh voters per MLA. MP, probably 20 lakh or 15 lakh. Under these circumstances, the power is much more vested in the party than in the candidate. So that itself makes it a much more kind of authoritarian control of the party leadership. And much less, like look at the number of independent MLA MPs, particularly in the south of India and all, there's almost zero, right? Then you go, and then you have an Anti-Defection Act, which says that I can't vote my conscience if I get elected on a ticket. I have to vote what the whip says I have to vote or lose my seat. So effectively, the role of the legislature is all but gone. The legislature, whoever has a majority, the legislature is a rubber stamp for the government. That's basic. So out of the three pillars, one pillar is already gone. Then you have what many would consider, undesirable, I won't call it unholy, though some might, nexus between the administration and the judiciary. Now you don't have strong enough judiciary. And my good friend, the learned judge, is my classmate from boarding school from 40 years ago. So, with him in the audience, I say this distinction or the ability to have such a strong judiciary that can hold the administration accountable is almost a myth now, right? We have seen so many instances, things like the EWS constitutional amendment. So I think the bigger problem today, we'll have a census, we'll have redistricting, or we want, or they'll do another equivalent of the 84th Amendment, maybe, maybe not. But my immediate concern is much more than devolution, much more than redistricting. It is the roles of the three arms of government as seen in the Constitution. All those are not functioning, in my view, not only as was envisioned in the Constitution, they're not functioning nearly as well as they used to 20 or 30 or 40 years ago. That has seen huge erosion. That worries me a lot immediately.
I just want to thank the minister. Rajkumar titled this a fireside chat. And I think that's in a way prescient. Raj is in many ways prescient, and this is one of them, because the term fireside chat started with Roosevelt when there was the Great Depression in 1933. He said he will talk to the people directly, and he had to explain the New Deal, which had a lot of complexity. It wasn't a simple thing. And he had the ability, Roosevelt did, of explaining what are the terms, how is he going to save the banks from being collapsed. These are technical issues, but he was able to communicate that to people in ordinary language, as the minister has just done. So I'm saying prescient because this country needs a new deal in the management of its economy, and the prescience part of it is that one day PTR will be in the leadership that gives India a new deal. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I have one last question, especially what the student had raised. We have hosted during this convention, you and Dr. Shashi Tharoor and many others as well, including parliamentarians, some of them. And the question that the student asked was that, what can we do to attract more young people to enter into politics? Now, at the dawn of independence, we had leaders, including Mahatma Gandhi, who studied in a UK-based university. You had Sardar Patel, also studied in UK. Subhash Chandra Bose studied in UK. Rajendra Prasad studied in UK. Ambedkar studied in US and UK. And your grandfather studied in UK. You had individuals who led the freedom movement and had world-class education. Now, 75 years later, I don't want to go deep into the situation of both national and state politics. What has happened to all those people who essentially were such highly educated individuals who were willing to not only enter into public life, but made huge professional and personal sacrifices to contribute to public interest? How do we respond to that aspiration of that student? Because the reality is, most educated people today have no interest whatsoever to be even in the proximity to the political life.
Look, I was just thinking that when I saw this, when I listened to some of these debates, I was thinking, at one time, there were intellectuals in politics, right? Myself included, I'm saying the weighted average has dropped a lot since then. But I think, part of it, as I say, is just this ratio of representation has gone wrong. The nature of politics has decayed. If you have to stand in an election and get 15 million people's attention in like the 1 month time that you have to be a candidate, there's no other way to do it but to go and align with some platform. The bigger the platform, the greater the chance of success, right? So the nature of politics has gone from being potential elected representative to people to being kind of a brokered deal with the party, right? And so no wonder nobody wants to come and, you know, we are not being assessed for the most part on your education or your intellectual ideas or your, you know, unique capabilities. So the system is broken. Having said that, I would say there are lots and lots of people that I know who will happily, at least they've been so successful, they don't care about, you know, money anymore or finance anymore or, you know, achievement anymore. There are many, many brilliant people who would love to contribute, who have the urge to be patriots, to be good fellow citizens. But the system has no way of providing a path for them. I mean, there are seats like Rajya Sabha seats, where at least some of the parties look for intellectuals and, learned people to fill those seats. But in the electoral system, the only place that I have ever suggested, and because this is doable, where the scale of representation is a few thousand to one, if you're going to the local body, your council, the city of Madurai, the village of X, the district of A, there you can win as an independent. In fact, many independents win. In fact, in some of these races, we don't allow party symbols. You don't get to say I'm DMK or Congress or BJP or whatever, right? So I think if you really want to participate, you want to participate at the grassroots, because that's where really the action is and that's where the connectedness with the people is. The problem is, if you take somebody who's already been kind of CEO of a company and built and sold a company for $1 billion, they are not used to the scale of saying, I'll go sit in my village or my city and run for city council, right? They think at state level or federal level or something. So there's this kind of disconnect. And most people who can think that going to the local body is a great success, they don't have this exposure to other things in life, and they've not kind of made the kind of progress, right? So profoundly, it's because our population has gone up almost 5x. The number of seats have not changed that much. And the dismantling of individual kind of value because of the scale and because of the anti-defection law has made it pretty much a party system rather than individual system. And we have to fix that. We need a new deal.
All right. Thank you very much for this fascinating freewheeling conversation. We are deeply grateful to Dr. Thyagarajan for taking time out to be here. What you heard is somebody who spoke from his heart, but also who has lived a life of pursuing those intellectual ideas and also contributed to both private and public sector, and somebody who is now in a position to influence public policy and governance. We are deeply grateful to you, sir, for taking time out.